Hello world! Welcome back to this new video. In the previous video, we talked about the new file system I implemented, ZealFS. Thanks to it, we now have two storages on Zeal 8-bit computer that we can use. A read-only file system stored on the ROM, or NOR flash, and a read-write file system stored on the I2C EEPROM. The main advantage of the I2C EEPROM is its small form factor and its price, but it's quite limited in terms of size. The one I use on Zeal 8-bit computer is 64 kilobytes. The biggest I2C EEPROM available on the market is around 512 kilobytes. So how to do if you want more space? Well, we need another storage that allows bigger sizes. And this is why today we are going to see how to interface a Zeal 8-bit computer with a CompactFlash memory. Let's get started. CompactFlash memories have a lot of advantages compared to hard disks, floppy disks or I2C EEPROMs. They have good capacities, ranging from a few megabytes up to 64 gigabytes. They are not very fragile. And finally, they are compatible with Parallel ATA or PATA protocol, also known as IDE. You may have heard about IDE protocol as it used to be the interface present on our hard disks before. Thanks to this interface, we will be able to connect a CompactFlash directly to the Z80 data bus without the need of a microcontroller or an FPGA. And this is what we are going to do today. CompactFlash memories implement three protocols of communication: PC card memory mode, PC card I/O mode, and true IDE mode. The one that we are interested in is the last one, true IDE mode. Usually, IDE interface uses 16-bit data, but with a CompactFlash, it's possible to enable the 8-bit mode, which makes it even easier for us to handle it. Communication in IDE mode consists in 8 registers that are used to initiate transfers. Here they are. Register 0 is the data register. Input and output bytes will be received and sent through this register. Register 1 is the error and feature register. When reading from it, it tells us the code of an error that just occurred, if any. When writing to it, we tell the CompactFlash the feature that we want to enable or disable. Register 2 is the number of sectors to transfer. The sectors are 512 bytes big. Even if we want to read a single byte from the disk, we must read the whole sector it belongs to. Then come register 3, 4, 5, and 6, which represent the sector address. And finally, we have register 7, which is the status and command register. When reading from it, it gives us the status of the CompactFlash, and when writing to it, we tell the CompactFlash to perform a command. And that's it. Quite simple, right? The fact is, everything is described and documented in the official specification of CompactFlash. Let's see a concrete example, activating the 8-bit mode. In the specification, page 113, we have the list of commands. We can see that one of them is set features. Its hexadecimal value is EF. Further down the document, page 148, we can find the description of this command. It tells us that register 1 shall contain the feature we want to enable or disable. The table of features is just below. As you can see, if the value of feature register is 1, it will activate the 8-bit mode. In short, the steps are: write 1 to feature register, which is register 1, then write EF value to command register, which is register 7, and that's it. This will activate the 8-bit mode on the CompactFlash. To interface a CompactFlash with Zeal 8-bit computer, I'm going to make my own PCB with this kind of connector. Then I will plug this PCB on the external connector of Zeal 8-bit computer. I'm going to use KiCad to make the PCB. So let's see the symbol for the CompactFlash connector. First of all, data 0 to data 7 pins will be connected to the Z80 data pins. Data 8 to data 15 can be left unconnected as we will use 8-bit mode. To address the 8 registers, we only need to connect 3 address lines. We will connect them to the lowest 3 address lines of the Z80. All other address lines must be connected to D&D. Then only chip select 0 must be used as the enable signal, while we pull CS1 high with a 1K resistor. ATA cell must be activated, so we tie it to G&D because it's an active low signal. Same goes for C cell. Write enable is not used in IDE mode. We can connect it to a pull-up resistor. However, we will use IO read and IO write pins, and we will connect them directly to the Z80 read and write signals. Same goes for the reset pin. We connect it to the Z80 reset pin. Then we have DASP or disk activity signal, that we will connect to an LED so that it will be enlightened when there is activity on the disk or when the disk is busy. PDIAG, we can connect it to VCC via a pull-up resistor, we won't use it. And finally, all the remaining signals can be left unconnected. In terms of pinout of the card, it will give us this. On the other side, we also have the part that will connect to Zeal 8-bit computer. And to determine the address of the compact flash in the I/O mapping, we have to generate the chip enable signal. When prototyping, I like to use programmable logic chips, or PLD, to generate combinatorial logic signals. It lets me easily fix my signals or add other signals in case I overlook the detail on the slave device. In this case, I tie address 7 to address 3 and I/O request signal to my PLD. It will output a low signal on the CFCS line if and only if address 7 to address 3 are respectively low, high, 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 and low. And of course, if I/O request is low because it's an active low signal. In other words, the compact flash will be mapped on the I/O bus from address 70 to 77 in hex. After finalizing the schematics and routing the PCB, here is the final result in KiCad. Nice. After quickly checking the schematics and routing one more time, I sent it to the PCB manufacturer. While the PCB was being manufactured, I wrote a small program in Z80 assembly that reads the first 512 bytes of the compact flash. In other words, the program will read the first sector. First, I defined the address of the registers I talked about earlier. I also defined the commands I will need, like read sector and set features. The main routine is here. First, I print a message with write macro, which is provided by Zeal 8-bit OS. Then I wait for the compact flash to be ready. I will often need to do this. In fact, every time we need to perform an action on the card, we first need to make sure it's not busy. To do so, it's very easy. We read the status register and we check for both ready and busy bits. Back to the main routine. We enable the 8-bit mode, as I explained earlier, thanks to the set feature command. Then we pass to the card the first sector address, which is 0 in our case. We fill the LBA registers with zeros. We set the number of sectors to read to 1, because we only want to read 1. And then we tell the card to perform the read with a read sector command. Finally, we send read buffer command so that the flash card stores the sector it read into its internal buffer. After all of this, the sector should be ready and we can read its 512 bytes one by one by reading successively the data register. The rest of the code will print the bytes in hex on the screen. That's it for the Z80 program. And we are on time, the PCB just arrived. It looks even better in real than on the KiCad preview. It's time to solder it. I start with the connector itself. Although it's possible to use a hot air gun, I prefer to use my soldering iron. I add some flux first. I pass my iron through all the pins. After that, I check the pins thanks to my microscope. If some pins are loose, I simply pass the soldering iron over them again until they become solid. The compact flash fits perfectly. Time to solder the other components. Here is the final result. To test it, I flash the program I presented earlier to the ROM. I set up the board and connect the compact flash to the extension port. Let's power on the board. Nothing. The board doesn't boot.
Oh no!
If I take the compact flash board out, the system boots. So definitely there is a problem with the compact flash PCB. After investigating, it turns out the port is upside down. Well, it's more like my PCB is wrong. The footprint for the connector is mirrored. The compact flash should be put with bottom up. This connector doesn't let me do this, however. That's okay, I still have few PCBs and I have a connector that accepts an upside down card. So let's do this. Time to solder the board again and check the pins for any bridge with my multimeter. The new board is soldered, we can test it again. On my Linux computer, I pre-flashed the first 256 bytes of the compact flash card with the sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc, etc. Let's see if we can retrieve and see this sequence. The board boots, that's great. We can execute our test named main.bin. Voila, we are finally able to read the first sector of the compact flash. We can see the sequence I wrote with my computer, and then the rest of the sector is uninitialized. That's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any question, as usual, feel free to leave a comment, and see you next time.